My wife, Molly Leach, who designs all the books and does the typography, she was working for a magazine at the time, and coincidentally, her coworker was Jon Scieszka's wife. And they, since I had the Halloween book out, she said, Jerry, John's wife, said, you know, you should meet my husband because he wrote this story, true story, The Three Little Pigs, and he's been rejected by every publisher out there. And maybe you can illustrate. And I said, I don't want to do that. And but I met him and I liked him and I read the story and I said, okay, I'll do up a book dummy. So I did a book dummy and I did a couple of paintings and I said, I'll get this published. So then I took it around and I got rejected by four or five more publishers until finally we ended up at a publisher, Viking, that took a chance on it. So we actually owe everything to our wives for getting us together. But even then, you know, that was 1989. That was pretty unusual for the time, this satirical children's book. There had been funny books and gentle, humorous books, but that was kind of parody and satire. So they were very tentative about it and put out a few thousand copies, and they sold out. And it was strictly word of mouth from teachers and librarians. My wife and I, the way we work is it's pretty collaborative. For instance, with the new book, John, Paul, George, and Ben, we wanted to capture an 18th century feel. So together we looked at broadsides and old chapbooks and primers and 18th century fonts and figured out how the relationship between the words and the pictures are. And the borders. Borders were very important back then to separate text from illustration, and it's a real back and forth thing, but it's all in service of the jokes, really. The page turns to make the jokes work. And I mean, I'm really going for the laughs with that stuff. And also Molly tends to be a little more classy. If left to her own devices, I would, John and I, or myself would do everything in kind of comic book type and balloon type, and she always goes for elegant fonts and things. So I think that kind of counterbalances the goofiness with this kind of classy, elegant approach. It is funny because I love those guys, John Hancock, George Washington, Paul Revere, Ben Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, the founding fathers. I love them. And I've always read biographies of them. And when I go to a museum, I always go to the American wing first. But unfortunately, I'm one of the stinky cheese guys, and so what I'm best at is kind of poking fun at things. And actually, there was a review that I read that I like. I don't usually read my reviews, except for all of them. But this one said, you know, Mr. Smith is not, he's not making fun of history, he's having fun with history, which I couldn't have said it better myself. And I'll have to slip her some Franklins for that. But I started with true anecdotes. Like Paul Revere really was a bell ringer in the Old North Church. And then I read later that was the same church where they suspended the two if by sea, one if by land, two if by sea lanterns. And I thought that was kind of interesting. And I would think he was also famous for being the most famous screamer in history, you know, the redcoats are coming. So I think, well, maybe he talked loud because he rang those bells and they took a toll on him and he couldn't hear himself think. And in my mind, that all kind of makes sense. But I mean, so at the back of the book, we have ye old true or false question that we've labeled taken liberties, which was my editor, Alessandra Balzer's idea, because I originally was just going to put fun facts because I wanted to straighten things out and let everyone know that it's okay to have fun with history, but there are some facts and there is a lot of fun. So she suggested we make it into a true or false section, which I love that idea because it's immediately just one more opportunity to make even more jokes and get more facts in there. So that's kind of nice because they could read the whole story, they could have a few laughs, there's some big underwear in there, there's some powdered wigs, and then at the end they can you know, figure out, oh yeah, he just made that up for a joke, but that was true, and George Washington didn't have wooden teeth, and you know, this and that. But you know, the origin of these stories too. Parson Weems, the guy who wrote the famous George Washington and the cherry tree story, he made that whole thing up too. And as I say in the book, he wanted to teach a lesson in honesty, and I think that's ironic because, you know, it was a big fat lie. What do I like about Jon Scieszka's work? He has a funny name, he's funny looking, and he writes funny. So we had three things going for us. His story, he comes from a similar background that I do as far as growing up with Robert Benchley and S.J. Perlman and Monty Python and Rocky and Bullwinkle. So we just had this language that we spoke. We didn't even have to speak it. You know, he would send me a story and I would laugh, and I would give him a drawing and he would laugh, and we'd put it together. But also he's great because at the time I met him, he was still teaching third grade. So we would go into the classroom and we'd have this great little focus group. And you would read lines like, "Your old granny can sit on a pin," or "Dead as a doornail." And you see what gets the laugh. The thing with kids' books is it's easy to work, you know, comedians that work blue where they could just throw in a curse word and all that. Kids' books, you have to kind of temper that because anyone could put in a passing gas joke or whatever, but you have to kind of, it's like, you know, your arsenal, you have to be selective about that. So, and John's pretty good about that. He'll put maybe one belch and that's it. So I've learned from the master. Otherwise, all the founding fathers would be wearing big underwear. Right, Hooray for Diffenduffer Day was the last book that Dr. Seuss was working on when he passed away, and it went in a drawer for a number of years. But his longtime editor, Janet Schulman, kept thinking about it and coming back to it. And she called me about it and asked if I would do it. And I said no, because I'm a big Dr. Seuss fan, and I just didn't, you know, I didn't think I could live up to that. And then she would call back again, and then she said, we've talked to Jack Perlutsky, and he's willing to work on it. And I think what worked for me was when I asked if we could incorporate all of Seuss's original drawings and notations, in addition to the book that we would create, just being a fan and an opportunity to see any of his early sketches. And we come back to that collage issue, because I was doing a drawing and trying to do it in my own style, but incorporate little bits of Seussian visual flourishes. And I collaged, I think, Horton's head on one of the characters or something. And it suddenly made sense, and it worked in a way that I hope that was a tribute to him, but my own concoction. And that's how I solved that book. And people who see it will say it's a hybrid, really, of Seuss and my own stuff. And also it was an excuse to go to La Jolla and go through his stuff, you know, knock on the door of the widow Seuss, Geisel. And I was able to stay there and have lunch and look at his artwork and look at the view he looked out on as he created all these great books. And so, yeah, that was a real rare, you know, fantastic experience. And I think Seuss was probably a big influence on myself and Jon Scieszka. If you talk about Green Eggs and Ham or The Cat in the Hat, I mean, it all goes back to that. That guy was the most, you know, subversive of all. But you know, another guy that kids love. There's these people like Sendak and Seuss that sometimes parents might think the stuff's a little edgy, but the kids are always the first ones to just love that stuff and get it. Yeah, does it faze me when a parent might take offense at something? Actually, it does, and I have a little bit of a thin skin about that. And my family all lives in Oklahoma, and it's a more conservative area. And I know some of my relatives, when I did Halloween ABC, thought that was maybe not such a great thing to do. And the fact that Stinky Cheese Man is fairly stupid tales, stupid in the title, that's kind of a bad word there. I do have this dilemma. I like edgy things. I'm attracted to them, but I wish I could do just kind of a sweet thing. And I start out sometimes doing sweet things, but they just come off kind of goofy. And then when someone who looks like my, you know, Aunt Velma or Aunt Pauline or something says, oh, we didn't think that was right, I say, I know, I'm sorry. And you know, so it does affect you, but yeah, you just soldier on, and I guess you have to do what you have to do. But yeah, I've never had a kid say that, ever. I've never had a kid take offense at anything. Okay, I'll put on ye old wig now and read a selection from John, Paul, George, and Ben. This is the story of Paul. Paul was a noisy lad. Before fun was invented, people joined bell-ringing clubs. As a member at Boston's Old North Church, Paul spent hours practicing in the Belfry Tower. Over time, that bell-ringing took a toll on young Paul. All day, his head was filled with loud bings and bongs. He had to practically scream just to hear himself talk. Now, that's fine around the Belfry, but not at work. Extra large underwear? Sure, we have some. Let's see. Large, large, extra large. Here they are. Great, big, extra large underwear. Paul was like a bullhorn in a china shop. Your wig? Yes, it's coming. And your polka dot shirts are coming. And the pink breeches are coming. It took many years and a midnight ride for people to finally appreciate his special talent. The red coats are coming. Everyone except that big underwear lady, she was still mad. And the thing is I on this tour, I've been able to go around to different parts of the country, and I was at the Smithsonian recently, and I was in their, you know, their acquisitions room, and I asked if they had any Frank Revere silver, because he was a great silversmith, and then I asked him about that rumor about the underwear, because people have said that I've made that up. I don't know. But the guy let me borrow this. I don't know if we can get on camera. This is actually from the Smithsonian. It's Paul Revere's from the shop. And inside, I think we have settled the matter once and for all. See, so it's big, great, big, extra large underwear. You probably can't zoom out wide enough to get the large underwear, but maybe if you want to put the on. Yes, it is. So, you know, it's fun going through airport security with these.
Wait a minute, is that true?
Yes, that's true. You think I would lie? It says right there, Paul Fair, that's his signature.
Let's see. Tell me that. Yes.
Just tilt it down just a pinch. There we go.
Believe it or not.
The Reading Rockets Meet the Author series is a production of WETA. Major funding for Reading Rockets comes from the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs. For more author interviews, recommended reading lists, and information about teaching kids to read, please visit us online at www.readingrockets.org.